Hello and welcome to day two of the 2022 Fulbright International Seminar. I'm Angela Rodel. I'm the Executive Director of the Bulgarian American Fulbright Commission. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here with us today. Some of you I can see were with us yesterday. Welcome back. We see some new faces. We're always glad to have new people join the discussion. Today, the overall topic of the seminar this year will be strategies for strengthening democracy and the rule of law. But every day we'll have a specific focus. Yesterday, we set the theoretical foundations. We talked about justice, civic awareness, how to understand the challenges that young democracies are facing. Today, we're going to shift a little bit and talk about how can we define national interest. And so our first panel today is going to help us sort through some of those questions. The panel title is Capacity of Democratic Institutions for Defining and Protecting Long-Term National Interest. With us today for this panel, we have three discussants. Radan, Kanev, a member of the European Parliament, Dr. Denitsa Hinkova, professor at Sofia University, and Professor Martin Belov from Sofia University as well. We'll first be hearing from Radan Kanev. Many of you likely know him as a Bulgarian politician. He's currently serving as a member of the European Parliament as part of the EPP group. He began his political activities as a very well-known political blogger in 2004. He has served in the Bulgarian Parliament, and he was chairman of the center-right Democrats for a Strong Bulgaria and as co-chair of the parliamentary group of the Reformers Bloc Coalition. Today, he will be talking to us as our first panelist. Thank you, Radan Kanev.
Thank you very much. First of all, thank you for the invitation. It was a great pleasure last year, and it's even bigger one now. That's why I will directly start by referring to my presentation 1 year ago. And I think there is a very strong link between the topics then, speaking of the communication crisis in which modern democracy finds itself, and speaking of defining national interests through institutional order today. So just a year ago, I argued that political debate, being in a quite deep, albeit very natural political crisis, mainly due to revolution in modern communication technologies. As, by the way, many times in history, such a revolution in communicating caused significant political upheaval. And that the democratic political debate find an interesting way out of this crisis by mostly spontaneously electing what I then called technocrat visionaries. People more or less out of the political status quo, but centrist, pragmatic, and quite often, although not necessarily young. And I gave two main examples, I think it's very interesting to follow their political development for this only 1 year from last September. They were Emmanuel Macron and our ex-Prime Minister Kirill Petkov, who was not Prime Minister yet at that time, but he was in a very good position to become one. By the way, both developed quite a good personal relations, I would say unsurprisingly, maybe even a kind of friendship. But looking just a year later, we might easily assess that the model of going out of this serious political crisis through the pragmatic figures of those type of outsider visionaries seems like an uneasy and not very stable solution. Because looking at these two main proponents, now we see Kirill already ousted of power and not near to coming back in my point of view for the moment, and Macron in very, very difficult political position after the elections in France, especially after the parliamentary elections in France, who left him without a parliamentary majority, which is a rather surprising situation for the French democracy model, to have newly elected president who cannot win majority in the National Assembly. And assessing the two cases, I might say, very much into the topic of today's discussion, that although in different ways, both fail to accommodate with national institutions as such. In the case of Kirill Petkov, he, in my opinion, didn't really struggle to reform Bulgarian institutions, and especially crucial ones when defining what national interest is. On one side, the media market being extremely vulnerable and, of course, very important in defining what is a priority for the nation, what is not. And the other side, the very institutions who are established to safeguard order and lasting priorities, for example, security services. In the Bulgarian case, the failure to reform those institutions left a good public image and a good political result somehow pending in the air without stable foundations. And as we saw, the government was easily overthrown. In fact, it was the easiest oust of government in recent Bulgarian history. In the case of Macron, I would rather say that what he didn't manage was to accommodate his image, his priorities, and even his party itself into the very strong and traditionally established conservative institutions of the French society. He remained a very much foreign figure to the French public debate. And some months before the presidential elections, he suffered a very, very significant defeat on the regional elections in France. A lot of people even made the forecast that he might lose the presidential elections. This was not my opinion. But losing regionals in France means losing touch with civil society, which is very conservative in the French case. He managed to win presidential elections, he failed to win parliamentary elections, and he is in very, very weak position to follow his national agenda now, to define national interest and to promote his vision of French national interest and French national strategy. In his second term, he is a much weaker visionary than he was in his first term. So here we come to the question. And I must say my presentation today is more of a provocation and more of a beginning of a debate, food for thought than giving answers. Because the question in my point of view is how could visionary politicians, which we obviously dearly need in the present situation, accommodate themselves with by default conservative national institutions in order to produce their vision into a national strategy. Because vision could become a national strategy only through accommodation or significant reform and accommodation of existing national institutions and existing pillars of civil society. And once again, I will say it, very often when speaking of civil society, we understand the reform is part of the society. This couldn't be more far from truth. Civil society is usually a very conservative part of society, a very established one, I would say maybe for the good in France and maybe for the bad in Bulgaria, but still it's the same case. So how could we accommodate brave political vision, new political image, new energy with existing institutions in order to produce a clear vision of national interest and based on this clear vision established a real national strategy, something which in today's world, much more than in past years' world, I think is extremely needed. And that's very easy to be seen. And when I say it's just food for thought, and I'm more interested in your comments and your answers, then my view is that if I knew the answer, I'd probably be a successful PM of Bulgaria, but I'm rather not. So I don't pretend having the answers. I would even say as a conclusion, very much differing from Douglas Adams' deep thought computer, I know the question, but certainly not the answer.
Good. Well, thank you so much for those comments. Yeah. So this will leave us a lot of time for questions. I'm sure there's many questions. This is a very topical.
That was the point of being so brief.
Yes, topical
because,
theme.
Because
yeah,
it's
yeah.
a question.
Exactly. But I'd like to hear from our other panelists first, and then we'll have a nice long period where you can. So if you have questions for Mr. Kanev, please write them down. Our colleagues who are online, I see quite a few familiar names of Fulbright alumni. It's great to see you guys online here. There's a Q&A channel on the Zoom. For our colleagues who are watching on Facebook, unfortunately, we won't be taking questions from Facebook, but you can jump on the Zoom link if you'd like to type some questions in the Zoom Q&A.